Good morning. Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Goshen, for your invitation to this important conference. I wish you all the participants a fruitful conference. This is an opportunity for me to point out some important aspects of the new law, insolvency and economic rehabilitation. This new law will come into power next year in September 2019. This is a very important law, which includes hundreds of sections. The law considers a number of insolvency, the law consolidates a number of insolvency laws, unifies the procedures of the insolvent, individual and the corporate, adopts in its provisions court's ruling in matters not yet legislated, provides, provides a mechanism for insolvency proceedings, etc. I prefer to illustrate these aspects through cases which are not taken from my free imagination, because I don't have imagination. It reminds me that my wife always complains, Eitan, you are a boring person, you don't have any imaginations, only facts, figures, balance sheets, and court files. That's it. Okay, so I changed some of the facts, as you will see soon. So let's presume Judge A, or Judge Smith, whatever. This judge presides in the bankruptcy court in the Tel Aviv District Court. Well, the judge, Judge Smith, or Judge A, whatever, finishes hearing a large number of cases in his courtroom and returns in the afternoon to his chamber. On his desk, he finds several new heavy files. Let's see what these files are. Okay. So here is the Cohen family. The Cohen family, Mr. David Cohen and his wife Ruth, and their three children, Ron, Dan, and Ella. The Cohen is a very well-off family. The family lives in a mansion in a very exclusive neighborhood in Tel Aviv. They have real estate, million in the bank account, nice cars, vacations all over the world, etc. All the assets are registered under the name of Ruth and the children. David is the main shareholder of a company by the name of Asia LTD. He has got actually all the shares. The other shares belong to Africa LTD, another company. This, our world, the world company, has a number of subsidiaries, and each of these subsidiaries has assets in Eastern Europe. It has around 20 subsidiaries. I didn't have enough space in the slide. Some of the assets, the real estate, are under construction, some awaiting a permit, and others are only in the stage of changing the zoning. Well, Asia borrowed money from the public in the Tel Aviv Stock Exchange and issued bonds to the bondholders. Asia also pledged its shares in World to Bank Leumi. Now, our Asia is facing difficulties because one of the subsidiaries, this one, did not distribute profits on due time. So also, World didn't distribute profits to its shareholders, to Asia and Africa. So a snowball started to roll from the top of the hill down to the valley. And let's see what's going on. So now, our Asia. Let's see the debts of Asia. Asia owns to Bank Leumi, a secure creditor, 20 million Israeli new shekel. The bank has a lien on Asia shares in World Company. Sorry. The priority creditors, that are the tax authority, employees, and so on, the debt is around 4 million Israeli shekels. the bondholders. The bondholders, they have got a floating charge on the assets of the company. The loan is around 30 million new Israeli shekels. And last not least, the regular creditors, suppliers, etc., around 8 million new shekel. The total financial commitments is around 64 million new Israeli shekels. So now you remember Judge Smith returning to his chamber. He found on his desk these new files. Let's see what these files are. Number one, the scenarios. The bank, Bank Leumi, got an offer to sell the company's shares in World to a third party for 19 million new Israeli shekels. It means 5% less than the law. And the bank asked from the court to enforce the lien and to appoint a receivership on the shares and to sell them. This is case number one. Number two, the company itself filed a motion for stay of proceeding and to approve a creditor arrangement. Now, what is this arrangement about? This is a haircut. The arrangement is based on paying to the bank only 80% of the loan, 70% to the priority creditors, 55% to the creditors of floating charge, the bondholders, and 45% to the regular creditors. This is case number two. Now, one of the creditors filed a motion for liquidation decree and also a temporary liquidator. Why does he do that? Why? Anybody has a guess? What? Pardon? Well, who does it? It's the landlord. And the landlord is a priority creditor. So for him, it's better that it will be a liquidation than an arrangement. He will get more in liquidation than in arrangement. So he filed a motion for liquidation. Number four. I forgot to tell you, the company has got a land in Eilat and it loaned money from another bank for 2 million shekels and it didn't repay the interest. So the bank, it's a secure creditor, relies the lien on the land in Eilat for a debt of 2 million Israeli shekel in the execution of judgment office in Eilat. So why this file is in Tel Aviv? Because the company asked the judge to transfer the file from Eilat to Tel Aviv. Does the judge has the power to do so? Well, let me tell you that a little bit later. Now, the fifth case, the fifth motion, it's David himself. David filed a motion for a personal stay of proceeding and to approve a creditor arrangement. So he will get a debt exemption, a personal discharge. He also want to be after all this thing to get a personal discharge. So, we have five different motions concerning the same insolvent company and its shareholder. So what do you do? What do you think this Judge Smith should do? Shall he appoint a receivership on the shares, as Bank Leumi asked? Shall he appoint a trustee according to a creditor's arrangement? Shall he appoint a temporary liquidator? Shall he transfer the file from Eilat? These are five different motions. And there is a big confusion what the judge should do. Any ideas, Professor Goshen? So, okay, these are all dilemmas, judicial dilemmas. So let's say our judge decided to give the company a chance to achieve a creditor arrangement. Okay, he decided, let's give the company a chance to do so. So, the next stage is creditor meetings. Each type of creditors has to have a separate meeting. So let's see the creditor meetings. I made it easy. It wasn't like that, but I have not enough time. So, the secure creditor supports the arrangement. The priority creditor supports the arrangement in the required majority. The creditors of the floating charge support the arrangement in the required majority. Now, the regular creditors, 70% of all the creditors, support the arrangement, but they represent only 66% of the debt. So the company actually didn't achieve the approval of all the meetings of its creditors. So the question now is, could the arrangement be imposed despite the fact that the required majority was not reached at all creditor meetings? So this is one question the court has to handle now. Can he impose this arrangement although there is not enough majority in the creditors meetings? Another case, a case where the company is against this arrangement. A certain series of bondholders is filing a motion for creditor arrangement, claiming that the company is insolvent and that the arrangement should be imposed. This series is claiming that the company should be prevented from paying its short-term financial obligation because in the near future it will not have enough and it will not have ability to pay the appellant, and thus this is a forbidden preference of creditors. Now, the company claims on the other side that it is solvent. It has enough money to pay its debts on due dates. And as for the future, as long as the zoning of the lot is changed, you remember they have lots in Eastern Europe to build inside, expand, and also if the government will give a permit to open casino in the land in Elat, then it will be able to pay all its financial commitment. Well, to get the permission to open a casino in Elat in Israel, it's not so simple, but that's what the company is claiming in the court. Now, so, does the judge has the power, is there a ground to impose the arrangement despite the opposition of the company? And moreover, is there a basis to prevent future payments? Now, the company has to pay money, going on concern. So is it a ground to prevent, to give an injunction, a temporary injunction, to prevent the company from paying its current obligation? In order to understand this, I would like to comment a few words about the differences between liquidation and rehabilitation. Now, in liquidation, what we should do is maximize the realization of all the assets. We're actually closing down the company's activities, firing all the employees, and we usually don't have much of operation expenses, and divide the money among the creditors. Now, in rehabilitation, it's totally different. It's reorganization of the company. What we should do is, there is a haircut of the debts, closing down only unprofitable business, firing some of the employees, finding an investor, activating other businesses, but watching it's not in a deficit activity. So these are two different procedures. Insolvent, I would like to show you, to point out to you the differences between insolvent under the present law and under the new law that is coming next year. According to the present law, and however, just a preamble, many years, liquidation has been the main and the only way for an insolvent company that was regulated by the company ordinance. During the last two decades, a major change has occurred. More and more creditors' arrangements were approved by the courts. At the beginning, by adopting the American Chapter 11, which is without a statutory Israeli act. The president, in her words, showed us how we use the American system in our legal system. This was one of the cases, one of the important cases when actually, he was the president of the Tel Aviv District Court, in the Kur case, actually adopted Chapter 11 in order to heal, actually, that's what he says, the company, then, and not to put it into liquidation, as the bankers' trust asked from the court. Actually, anyways, in 1999, the parliament legislated the Company Act and formed Section 350. Which give the courts the power to approve creditor arrangements to insolvent companies. So if we focus on the insolvent, and I'll focus, this is according to the company ordinance from 1983. The most important thing is the company became insolvent. And the big question is what is insolvent? What does it mean when the company became insolvent? So that we have in another clause, in another section, it which says that the insolvency is, it has been proven to the satisfaction of the court, having taken into account the company's contingents and future liabilities that the company is unable to pay its debts. What does it mean, unable to pay its debts? Does it mean the short-time obligation or also the long-time obligation? Shall we use what kind of examination? Shall we use the cash flow test or shall we use the balance sheet test? The clause doesn't say. One, there have been big disputes on this question in the IDB development case, and if I have some more time, I will get to it later. But what we can see is transition from liquidation to rehabilitation. Judge Grunis, the former president of the Supreme Court, ruled in the case of Legin, it's the Pre-Hagalil factory in the northern part of the country, that in the preliminary stage, creditor's arrangement is preferable over liquidation proceedings. And in his judgment, he showed why should we prefer in the beginning to give the company a chance to achieve an arrangement than liquidation. Although, if the company is liquidated, you also can reach a creditor arrangement, but it's more difficult. What else can we see? We can see that imposing creditor arrangements on the company against its will, arrangement and stay of proceedings also on shareholders, and a creditor arrangement according to which the company goes to the creditors, public shareholders or bondholders. We found some companies that are public now and they don't have somebody who controls it. And fifth, the imposition of a recovery arrangement on the creditors even if there is no majority for the approval of the arrangement. The new law. Let's see what the new law is about. There is no doubt that the new law favors rehabilitation over liquidation. It's already reflected in the purposes of the law. In section 2, it says that this law is intended to regulate the repayment of the debts for individual or corporation, which is or is liable to be in a state of insolvency, so that, so let's look at the first phrase, to economically rehabilitate the debtor as much as possible. And the third, to enable the debtor to start a new economic life. It's a big change. The new law is a big change concerning rehabilitation if we compare it to the present law. Also, when opening the proceeding, the court should order one of those, the operation of the corporation for the purpose of its economic rehabilitation. Section 93, the sale of activity is ongoing business for the purpose of the economic rehabilitation. Now listen to that. Even if not with the plan of economic rehabilitation. So the court has the power to impose a creditor arrangement even if there is no plan of economic rehabilitation. Also in section 97, operating the company, the corporation as ongoing business in liquidation, even there is no arrangement. Section 87, again, imposing an economic rehabilitation plan even if the required majority has not been reached at the meeting. So also in section 86, I'll shorten it, okay. So what are the consideration of court as to whether to allow a rehabilitation plan to be implemented over liquidation? Well, not intervention rule, non-intervention rule, which means consideration are to be determined by the creditor, but as long as the decision is not motivated from non-fide regulation, yes, there will be, that's what we should keep, that they really decided it in bona fide. Now, the stage which the cooperation is when the application is submitted, and type of company, if it's a holding company, it's different than it's an operating company. The attitude it's when it's an operated company is to go towards creditor arrangement. Assets of the company, licenses, public, skeleton, and so on. Owner discharge and contribution of the controlling shareholder, what does it, how much and this shareholder contribute to the company. Now, insolvency in light of the new law. If we can see that even the definition of insolvency of the new law, insolvency is an economic situation in which the debtor cannot pay its debts on time, whether or not their due date has arrived, or that the debtor liabilities, including future and contingent liability, exceed the value of the asset. Now, is there a difference between the definition in the new law and the current law? Well, time will tell. I guess the court will have to interpret this in the near future, and there's a big dispute over it. There's also presumption of insolvency in the section 9 and section 10 of the new law. What are the presumption? Non-payment a debt of 75,000 in Israeli shekel, a receiver was appointed, a non-payment a debt of a judgment of a labor court of 10,000 new Israeli shekel. But the presumption may be rebutted by the cooperation if it proves that the non-payment of the debt does not originate from its insolvency. So the burden of proof is on the company. We change it. Now the company has to prove that it's solvent and it didn't pay, not because it's not solvent. Concerning future creditor, he may submit application only in one of these. The debt will not be repaid within 6 months. So, if there is a creditor that is supposed to get his money in a year, he cannot file a motion to court. Only creditors that are supposed to get their money within 6 months. I don't know why the legislator decided 6 months, but that's the new law. He also can file a motion if, in case the corporation acts to deceive its creditor or the corporation transfers assets in order to distance them from its creditors. Some benchmarks that helps the judges to decide whether the company is insolvent. Non-compliances with the covenants, the auditors put a comment in the financial statement, difficulties repaying the debts, a decrease in the company rating, negative balance of profits for distribution, liability to raise capital, difficulties in realizing assets, selling at loss. You can see different attitudes in judging insolvency. In the IDB development, in a temporary proceeding, insofar as there are warning signs that justified appointing an observer to the company. Some benchmark that help to reach this decision. In the case of the Israeli pots, the court ruled that it's enough that the company is in a zone of insolvency to impose a creditor arrangement. But however, former judge Al-Sheikh, in the case of IDB holdings, decided, in a different opinion, that only when insolvency has been proven, then the company is insolvent. But we can see also in the new law a big change in this attitude. Thank you very much for your listening.